All right. All right, that takes care of the physical needs of our anatomy. And right after that, or at 1:30, if you can, we're going to do our first packing party. The objective is to do 100-200 boxes this Sunday. The following Sunday, we'll do another 200. And then we'll do a few more after that, whatever's left over. And I suspect that we'll get over and above and beyond where we plan to have our goals set at. And I think that's great because I think the Lord has blessed us. I know this congregation has been wonderful as far as participating and being generous givers as in many situations. So that, with that, we've got a couple of people that are sick. Sarah was sick this morning or not feeling well. And as you can see, Linda is hobbling along, and I'm coming along just fine, too. You've heard the saying. You've heard it say, hop along and get along. So I'm getting along. All right, let us begin with a word of prayer. Thank you, Father, for this morning, for blessing us. We thank you, Father, for the cool temperature that we have this morning. And we pray, Father, for the rain that is prospective for us to have. We pray that it may nourish our land and do the ground well. Thank you, Father, for your continued blessing and for your love that you've given us. Thank you for your Son who died on the cross and rose again on the third day so that we can have salvation and have a home with you at the end of this life's walk. Be with us all throughout the morning and let us worship you with honor and with glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Today I will be reading from 2 Corinthians 1, verses 3 through 7. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also abounds through Christ. Now if we are afflicted, it is for your consolation and salvation, which is effective for enduring the same sufferings which we also suffer. Or if we are comforted, it is for our hope for you and steadfast, because we know that as you are partakers of the sufferings, so also you will partake of the consolation. Let us pray. Father, thank you for this day to gather here and worship you and learn more about you. And I pray, Father, for thanks for your unconditional love and that you will never leave us nor forsake us, and for your Son's sacrifice on the cross to save us from our sins. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome, Grace Fellowship Church. Had a few mornings of fall this past week, felt wonderful, and we had a few afternoons of early summer again, before we fall back into fall again early next week. Always like, well, there's somebody that posted something about that. Love it when I can turn my air conditioner off and open the windows, and then close the windows back about noon and turn the air conditioner back on, and then open the windows back up, then turn the heater on at night, and it's such Texas weather. Well, hey, God is good. It gives us all those different things to enjoy. So, hey, let's stand and talk about how great our God is. Our God is greater.
Thank you.
for us, and who could stand against us? It's not bragging if it's true, right? It's not bragging. It's just the way it is. All right, next song we haven't done in well over a year. Well over a year. I had to pull it out of the folder. It was actually still in the eyes. Which, if you see my folder, there's like the stack this much that's out of the folder, and there's like this much that's actually in alphabetical order. So, so but anyway, called I Will Lift My Eyes. Has a little intro first. God, my God, I cry out, your beloved needs you now. God, be near, calm my fear, and take my doubt. Your kindness is what pulls me up. Thank you. Father, we thank you so much that we can come sing your praises, celebrate you as God. We lift our eyes to the healer, the calmer, the God of all. We thank you so much, Lord, that we can come straight to you as God. Bring all of our sorrows, all of our joys, everything going on in our lives. You just want to hear from us. And we just thank you so much for that relationship. We thank you so much, and we love you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Man, you may be seated. Pardon me. To take a scripture and go to the third chapter of the book of Ephesians, we're going to finish the Pauline prayer that we started last week. We're taking a little station break from 1 Peter. We'll pick back up with 1 Peter next week. We're going to look at the second half of Paul's prayer to the church at Ephesus, being filled with the fullness of God, and that's the emphasis of the pattern that we're going to see in the prayer. Several years ago, I told you that had the opportunity to lead our church through Jesus' prayers throughout Scripture, and then we looked at it in comparison to the Pauline prayers that we see in the epistles. And it's amazing how the Apostle Paul prays with the same mindset and the same rhythms that Christ prayed to his Father in. And I think it's only right for us to develop that kind of prayer life. And I told you last week, I'm not saying that I'm opposed to praying for people's illnesses or the fact that they in prosperity need a job or whatever, or traveling graces. Absolutely, I'm not saying that that's not important. But you won't find anywhere in Paul's prayers or in the prayers of Jesus Christ where that's the emphasis of their prayer. That's not the focal point of their prayer. The focal point of their prayer, primarily with the Apostle Paul, is sanctification, that we would grow in the image of Christ, that we would look more like Christ than yesterday, today and tomorrow a progressive state of growing up, of maturing in Christ. And so we're going to see what does that look like if he was going to pray as Paul is in the midst of a prayer, in the midst of the dynamic of praying to the Father. In the midst of this, how would he pray and what would he pray for? Throughout the remainder of his prayer, beginning in verse 17 through verse 19, you're going to see a lot of purpose clauses. I want you just to direct your attention before we read the text at the why of how Paul prays. He actually begins in verse 14 with this phrase, "for this reason." Every single time in the Greek, that's the word henna, H-I-N-A. It just means that what follows is what the word wants to give us in purpose. This is the reason why I pray this way. So he says, "for this reason." Drop down to verse 16, "that he." Those are the same purpose clauses. Verse 17, "so that." Look at the middle of verse 17, "and that you." Look at verse 18, "may be able." Look at verse 19, "and to know." And then he follows up with verse 19, "that you may." Every one of those statements, it's the word henna. We've translated it in the English language a little different, but it's just, this is the purpose of why I pray this way. The Apostle Paul does not say, "I pray this way and then I don't want you to get it. I don't want you to be able to comprehend what I'm praying for you." He prays that way so that when they walk away from this epistle in the church that's being read at Ephesus, they will know how Paul prayed and what Paul wanted them to be about as they walk through the fullness of their life in Christ. I'm going to say something that maybe we don't agree, and that's perfectly okay. But I do believe that personally, and when I say personally, I want you to understand that if you hold me to it as Scripture, I may not be able to go to the address. And so this is my opinion. I believe that most Christians in the Western world live less than what God called you to. And you're going to look at me and say, "well, Rob, I feel like I'm doing a pretty good job." Well, okay, great. When I'm measured against truth, when I'm measured against the Word, am I living the full life in Christ that God intended for me to live when He gifted me with Jesus Christ in salvation? Every single Pauline prayer has that motivation, that the people would live as though God were the fullness in their life. Not just in thought, but it would drive them in deed. They think the right way, therefore they act the right way. They know the right thing, therefore they do the right thing. For many of them, you could take a test, and if it was just a trivial Christian test, many of these that were going to receive the letter at Ephesus, they know all the right answers. It's not that they're ignorant to what Christ... Listen, Paul spent lots of time on the ground at Ephesus. He loved this church dearly. At one time, some 3 years. That was a long time for Paul. If you got Paul 3 years, you got a lot of Paul. This is a second go-around that now he is telling them, having left there and being arrested for the sake of righteousness, for the sake of preaching the gospel, trumped up charges. He sits in prison and he wants to touch base with them again. And for what purpose? Remember, purpose clauses, that they might live in the fullness of who they are in Christ. That they might come out of the nursery, get out of the crib, and they might walk the streets of maturity, of adulthood in Christ. Be grown up in the Lord. Be mature. And so as we read this letter in this Pauline prayer, in that mindset, listen to the way it's read. Now, I'm going to show you in Scripture how this could have been read. A lot of this in the middle of chapter 3 is like added nugget. He kind of starts and stops. So it can be read this way. And I want you to follow with me in your Word. In Ephesians chapter 2, beginning in verse 22, it can read this way. This is the intent of how we get to the prayer. He says, in whom you also are being built together into a dwelling of God in the Spirit. Chapter 3, verse 1. For this reason I, Paul the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles. Verse 14 of chapter 3. For this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in the inner man. Verse 17. So that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to all the fullness of God. And then he ends his prayer. That's like the amen. But he's going to give us a double, like a PS amen. He's going to give us a postscript. He's going to double it up like that PSS, SSSS. He's just going to tag it on the end of this. He finishes the prayer. And then I believe with all my heart, he is tethered to this Praetorian guard. And this guard is listening to this prayer. Whether he's a believer or not, he's got to be wowed by the fact that Paul goes right to the throne. And he just rushes the throne with aggression. And he says, God, for the people of Ephesus, I just want to pray this way. Please help them. Please grow them up. Please let them experience the fullness of who you are in them. And then he says this. He breaks into worship. Folks, this is what prayer ought to do. How many times have you been studying God's word, or you've been deep in prayer, in your prayer closet, or privately as you're walking down your lane, or you're driving and making a trip, and you just begin to express yourself in prayer. And before you know it, you're not praying anymore. You're just shouting hallelujah. God, what a God you are that you would even consider me. That you would call me and you would number me as one of your own. Folks, just think about your life before Christ. Those of you who came to Christ in maturity or had some age on you and some experience, you think about what you would have been outside of Christ. And Paul begins to pray. And then he just kind of takes a break and he says, but hey, I just want to worship. Now to him who is able to do exceeding abundantly beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power that works within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Father, thank you for this time this morning. And as we look at this passage together, find us faithful to rightly handle and divide the truth. But Father, more than this, I pray we would walk out of here and we would never view our life the same. That we would see it through the lens of Scripture. That having you as our Father, and having the boldness to come to you and confidence that you hear our cry through the work of Jesus Christ and the power of the Spirit that lives within us, that we would again aggressively live our life to the fullest in Christ. Father, teach us through this prayer. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Three things we learned last week. First, we learned that Paul's prayer was done in a certain posture. He says, I bow the knee. Okay, we know that spiritually you can bow the knee and never really touch your knee to the surface of the ground or your carpet. I believe with all my heart, looking at the original text, he actually bent the knee. He actually got out of his cot and he was on bent knee. Now, somebody else beside him either had to stand in an inconvenience or uncomfortableness, or had to get down there with him. So we've got a guard. And so we've got not just one, but we have one who's genuflexed unto the Lord, and his heart is conditioned to be bent toward God. And we looked at in Scripture that the bowing in the knee is significant in the Word of God because, one, it sets our heart in a place or a position, a posture of reverence. I'm going to revere God every single time you see a bent knee or face to the ground in the presence of the holiness of God. It is because they revere God above all. When a king would enter into the city and he would be making a proclamation with a herald coming out in front, here comes the king. They didn't bend the knee to the herald. Folks, they didn't bend the knee to the one who carried the message. But when the horizon would be broken in the eyesight of the people, and the king would be in their midst, they would bow themselves in reverence to the king. Folks, they did that in common language. And Paul does this spiritually He says, I bow my knee. And then he tells us who he bends the knee to. My Father. Abba, Daddy. Folks, there's an intimacy there that sometimes we just don't get. You guys, I don't call my dad Richard. That's his name. Why don't I walk up to my dad and extend my hand to him or embrace him with a hug and say, hey, Richard, how you doing? I still call him Dad. I'm going to call him Dad, I guess, until he passes. And then after that, when I tell a story about him, it's going to be my dad. I'm going to frame it in the fact that he is my father. Because there's an intimacy there. And Paul doesn't call him God at this point. He calls him Father. He says, I bend the knee in reverence. And there's an intensity of my prayer that I want the church at Ephesus to desperately receive this prayer in this letter. And Dad, if you would just weigh in on it, let them see you for who you are. Let them experience you for what you've done. Dad, hear my cry. Folks, I can tell you that if I called my father right now and I put him on speakerphone, he would be in church, so we'd have to wait. But if we waited till about 12:30 and we just stayed right here and I called him, and I would say to him, Dad, I need help. Tell me what I need to do. How do you need me to help you? Dad, I need you to give me a word of counsel. What are you dealing with? I'll help you. Dad, I need, what do you need? Folks, our heavenly Father knows far greater than my earthly father. He looked at the disciples at one point, Christ in his ministry. He says, if a good dad knows how to give good gifts to his kids, don't you think your heavenly Father knows how to give grand gifts? That if a child asks for a biscuit, is he going to hand him a snake or a rock? Folks, who are we in Christ? Why have we been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb? For just some ticket into heaven? Praise God, I get a ticket. I gain heaven and I miss hell. Praise the Lord, that's all I heard as a Baptist. Please, I'm not knocking just a Baptist. That's all I know. I don't know the Methodist. I don't know the Church of Christ. Maybe you did the same thing. But I don't want to just gain Christ when I enter into heaven. I want to know him and gain him every single day. And he says, I bow the knee to the Father. And then he talks about two things in his petition. We're going to pick up those petitions in just a minute. Two things in petition. Grant to them riches according to your great mercy or your great glory. Folks, we looked at this. He does not say out of. He says according to. Out of means he could be a multi-billionaire, have no limit to his funds, and he gives me $50. That's out of his riches. But if he gives me according to his riches, it's going to be in a line to the absolute bottomless pit of his riches. Folks, he didn't give me $20 out of his riches. He gave me according to. And what did it look like? Jesus Christ at Calvary. That's the riches of his glory. Could I ever outgive him? No. But here's the beauty. He's never asked me to. You know, all he asked me to do is by faith, receive by faith that which he provided for me at Calvary and sealed with promise at the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's all he's ever asked me to do. Rob, you can't outgive it. I'm not asking you to. I'm not asking you to come up with something that would be equivalent. I'm just asking, would you just receive that which I offer to you according to my riches and glory? Folks, he offered us the very best. And Paul says, man, this is what he's given you. But then he says, as a result of that, I want you to operate as though there is a strength within the inner man through the work of the Spirit. There's a strength. There's a dunamis. There's a power under control that when acted upon and when the Spirit begins to act upon us, we in supernatural strength begin to accomplish those things in Christ that we could not accomplish had it not been for Jesus Christ. You say, well, Rob, what are those things? For the first time in my life as a believer, for the very first time, I can now do the will of God I could not before. Folks, he didn't save me so that I could do whatever I wanted. He saved me so that I could do everything he willed me to do. Folks, that's a big old gift. I've received a lot of cool gifts. When I was a little boy, I wanted a pocket knife really, really bad one Christmas. And I just knew that my parents heard me loud and clear that I wanted a pocket knife. Everybody else at school had a pocket knife. I would have to either borrow one or take it for the day, unbeknownst to my father, off of his, off of his little area, his little side table. He had several of them, and I would just take one, slip it in my pocket, because everybody else had one at school. And if you're going to whittle and tell stories, you need to have a pocket knife. It's hard to whittle with your finger. And so I made it known, I want a pocket knife. I'm just a little guy. So Christmas rolls around, and there's a big old huge package underneath the Christmas tree from my parents. We got one gift, by the way. We got some stocking stuffers, underwear, socks, those necessities, a little thing of Tootsie Rolls or something. And then we got one gift. That's it. That's all we got. Big old huge box. And I'm thinking, man, I need a pocket knife. I could put like 1,000 pocket knives in that thing. That thing's too big. They didn't hear me. If you're going to give me anything else, and so I started playing it like this at breakfast. If you're going to give me anything else, I'm super appreciative. But man, I wish I had a pocket knife. Big old box, never moved. Christmas morning, my mom was the one that handed all the gifts. So I have this big box here and my stocking with all those necessities. And one at a time, we had to watch each other open the gift. I open my gift, big old huge box. There's another box inside of it, and another box inside of it, and I just keep opening, and they're all empty. And wrapped in a burlap sack, an old feed sack, about that big, wrapped multiple times. I'm unwrapping it, trying not to hurt whatever's inside. Out drops on the floor an old-timer pocket knife. They heard me. Wrapped in burlap. Guys, I almost missed the prize for the ugliness of the wrapping. Calvary was ugly. You'll miss the story of goodness if you just look at the cross. It was ugly. It was worse than burlap. It was worse than multiple boxes of emptiness under the tree. But when you got to the center, it's exactly what you needed. Folks, this is Paul's prayer to the church. We're going to pick up this morning some additional petitions that he asks of the Father on behalf of the church. We're going to move through this fairly quickly because, guys, there's no mystery in this. There's not like a hidden word that maybe can mean this in one text and maybe it means this in another. Nope. He just prays openly and it's very clear what he's asking. We've looked at through verse 16. Now we're going to pick up in verse 17. Again, a purpose clause or a purpose statement. So that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. This is the third petition that he lays at the foot of Christ. That Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. The conduit is through faith. Pistis. I trust God more than anything. I will lean into Christ above all. Well, what am I leaning into Christ for? If I look at the end, I'm going to miss the purpose statement. The dwelling or the indwelling of Jesus Christ in my life. The word dwell has a, in the original text, has a pretext or a prefix in front of the word. Oite is the word of dwell. Plain. But when you put kata in front of it, it emphasizes a strength to that word. He goes to the strongest word for dwelling that you can have in the Greek text. Kata oite, kata oie. He looks at this and he says, down, kata means down. I want you to, Father, grant to them a down. Oie means home or abiding or comfortable dwelling. Now listen, we have all these phrases in the English language that some of them are rooted in the Word of God. Have you ever heard the term down home? That's this phrase, kata oye. I want them to have a down home view of Christ. What does that mean? You said down home. It always is from our perspective, but this is from God's perspective. I press upon them aggressively that they would have a dwelling place where Christ feels comfortable and Christ is at home. Folks, have you ever been in somebody's home? You've been in their home, but you're not at home? Seriously. You're in their presence, you're in their wall that they would call their home, but you're not at home there. You don't feel received. It's not hospitable. You're uncomfortable. You don't know how to react. You don't know if it's okay if you're there or not. He says, no. It has to be more than, and we've heard this multiple times, I invited Jesus into my heart. That is not a biblical perspective of salvation. There is an outcome or an outcry as a purpose clause of purpose. Having been born again, I'm indwelt with the work of the Holy Spirit. Therefore, he resides within my heart. But listen, I can have a condition by which not only is he residing in my heart through the work of Christ in the person of the Spirit, but he's at home in my heart. He's comfortable with me and I with him. And he puts his feet up on the ottoman and he enjoys the Christmas of the fire. And he sips from the coffee cup that I have in hospitality offered to him. And he's just at home. Folks, Winnie and I both, and like some of you in this room, we were blessed with having godly parents. And one of the things that I noticed about our home growing up, if you came to our home, it was perfectly okay for you to kick your shoes off at the door and just come in and have a seat and fellowship, and you were at home. And if we were having a meal, guess what? There was always a plate because if we could add more water to the beans or whatever you were having, you were more than welcome to stay. My mom would have been offended if you would have said, no, I'll just stay in here while you guys eat, or I'll just excuse myself. Oh, no way. No. Wendy will bear witness to this. My parents to this day rarely have a meal that there's not some party in their home that does not belong there in the abode. Guys, I grew up with multiple kids in the community eating at our house every single night. They didn't care if it was leftover or not. They didn't care. She brought every little stray dog home. And they ate with us. Anybody that was coming through town stopped and they ate with us. We never ate that somebody wasn't sitting next to us that I would just have to hand the Kleenex to or the towel to wipe it. I didn't even know the person, but they were there to eat. Guys, you know what that means in the spiritual life? It means there's no friction. There's no wondering if is it okay if I put my feet under this table, and is it okay if I fellowship in this condition? It's okay. And Paul says, Father, Daddy, man, I want them to know that they can know you down home. Hospitality, where there's no friction, there's only peace. Well, he uses that picture of a home. Let me just tell you what that would look like if we actually ran this metaphor out. That means that in your library, he has the right to change your mind. That means when he leaves and goes to your living room, your den, he has the right to fellowship with you according to his good grace. It means when he goes into your dining room, he's going to satisfy your appetite on the Word of God because he is a good God. And when he goes to your workshop, you're going to diligently do the deeds in your workshop that's going to profess Christ in your day. And when you go to your area of recreation, even in recreation, he's welcome there. You say, well, Rob, I can check all those boxes. Oh, but when he goes to the closet of hidden things, he's down home. Folks, I can tell you right now, if you come to our house tomorrow and say, man, Rob, I want to check this down home thing out in y'all's life. Let's just see if you guys are the real deal. I'm probably not going to take you to our closet and open up and go, hey, well, come on in. Experience our closets. It's probably not going to happen. But can I just tell you what the true indwelling of the Spirit means? He can even go in your closet. Be perfectly welcome there. Folks, that's down home. That's what it means to be indwelt with the Spirit of God through the conduit of trust, faith. God, you can come into any room of my house. I trust you. Folks, you can leave your diamonds out on the table. You can leave your car keys on the bar. They're safe. Because Christ is down home in your heart. Well, that's the third thing that he prays for, but the first thing this morning. But listen, it gets better. This just like starts blowing up. So he says that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you may be rooted and grounded in love. This is the fourth clause, but the second of today. Rooted and grounded in love. That means that love is the central of that which we are attached to. That we are rooted, that means that the system goes out and down. It's both an agricultural term and an archaeological or an architectural term. That it's not just surface roots. It does have that value. That it is far-reaching, that it is rooted, it's grounded, it is a foundation. But it is also rooted in a depth. You've walked over to trees that look like they're a little bit sick, and you just push against the upright, the tree that looks like it is suspended, and it is very strong, and you push against it, and it just falls over. It has a very thin root system because it's not grounded. Build a house on a shaky foundation, and you have an unstable house. This is the whole understanding in Matthew chapter 7. One man built his house on the Word, Jesus Christ. And when the storms came and crashed against its walls, it did not fall. But the one who built his house on the sand, not grounded, not rooted in the truth, when the storms came, it fell. And the Scripture says, and great was the fall. That means there was not a brick upon a brick. There was not anything salvaged in that home. It was a rubble. I can tell you there are many Christians that have not grounded themselves or rooted themselves in the person and work of Jesus Christ through his word. And when pressed upon against the world and the frailty of our own heart, we fall like a house of cards. That is not Paul's prayer. Father, that Christ would be at home, down home in their heart, and that they would be so established and rooted in the truth in the person of Jesus Christ, no matter what hits their wall, they are firm in Christ. Big prayer. Okay, it gets better. So we see a understanding of strength, of riches according to his mercy, his glory, an indwelling through the work of faith, a rootedness and grounding in love. That's the basis. And now he's going to pick up on this little word, love. Agapeo, agape, unconditional, sacrificial, selflessness, volitional. This is a word that only God can produce in you. You can phileo, brotherly. You can eros, erotica. You can sorge, a friendship of fellowship. And all of those in the right context, they are perfectly okay. But you cannot agape love outside of God. Outside of Christ, there is no agape love. But look how he frames this. I want them to know how big God's love is in their life. He says, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend, grasp, kata, lambano. Again, we see it a prefix, kata, down, lambano, to grasp or to somebody to seize, lay hold of you. I want them to lay hold of this truth. I want them to comprehend this truth. He says, may be able to comprehend with all the saints. Not just some, but all the born-again, blood-bought children of God. I want them all to get this. What is the breadth, length, height, and depth of what? God's love. Guys, I'm going to frame this to you like this, and it's still cheap. I know my parents loved us. Not only did they say it, but sacrificially they did stuff for us that I know they loved us. I would open my lunchbox at school as a little kid, and there would be a note in there from my mom just expressing, Rob, I hope you're having a good day. You know mom loves you. Every single time we hang up the phone, whether I was talking to my dad or mom, you know how it always ends? Hey, Rob, we love you. Guys, my dad's late 80s. He has built more fence and pulled more wells and crazy stuff. All of it has missing fingers. Hans, nothing against having missing fingers. It just means you did something in your life to lose them. He's got the end of fingers gone. And he's just a wore out old man. But he never neglects. Even in that hard shell, he never neglects telling us, I love you. So I felt like, I understand love to some degree. I never understood it until I held our first son standing beside the birthing bed. One, I was wowed at Wendy. That's got to be, you women are the toughest people in the world. I've seen lots of animals birth growing up on the ranch. But when I saw what Wendy did, I'm telling you, man, I was high-fiving her. I wasn't actually high-fiving her, but on the inside, I was like, man, you are a champ. I'm going to start looking for that ass because you're a superwoman. How in the world did you do that and smile? Because I didn't have that experience where she was trying to break me or, you know, crush my hand or cussing me or whatever. She's just like a champion. She got it. I'm like, yes, a champ. And then they kind of toweled Keegan off. And they kind of wrapped him in a blanket. And they handed him to me. Man. Then I loved. I thought, gosh, this is mine. This is my kid. This is my baby. Then I got it. And Paul says, Dad, let them know that kind of love. Let them experience that kind of love. And then Colton came along in the same thing. Here you go, Dad. And I held him for the first time. And then he let us see it a third time. And I walked into a government office in China. And standing behind a lady clutched to her leg, I see a little girl. And he let us hold her. Folks, that's the love that the Father has, and we can't even express it. So in his kind of a cheap way, he says, hey, could you just start measuring some stuff off? God, I just want them to know your kind of love and all the measurements I can think of. And so he just kind of like gives them a ruler. And he goes, okay, measure the box this way. Okay, now measure it this way. Now weigh it this way. Now try to pick it up. You go, I can't. It's unlimited. It's priceless. Who could pay for that kind of love? But Jesus Christ paid it all. I'll show you four things that he says about God's love. Look at it with me. He says that all the saints would comprehend, grasp, get a hold of, really know how much God loves you. He starts first with breath. Well, I want to show you some passages of Scripture if you just bear with me. We're going to mainly stay in Ephesians, but I want to show you some companion passages. And so what is the breadth of God's love? How big is it? Well, I want to show you that there was a mystery up to this point about the gospel of Jesus Christ, and the Jews thought they were the only ones that could get it. And Paul reminds the church at Ephesus that he took that common wall of division between races and he made it a hubble. He knocked it down. Through the blood of Jesus Christ, both Jew and Gentile, both those of Israel and everybody else that's not of Israel, can know the same God through the same faith in Jesus Christ. Pick it up with me in chapter 2, verse 11. It's a beautiful passage of Scripture. Here's the breadth of God's love. And then we're going to go to Revelation. I'm going to show you something. Therefore, remember, as a result of that kind of salvation made alive in Christ, that formerly you, the Gentiles in the flesh, who were called uncircumcision, quote, by the so-called circumcision, the Jew versus the Gentile, which is performed in the flesh by human hands, remember that you were at that time separate from Christ, excluded from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who formerly were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who made both groups into one and broke down the barrier of the dividing wall by abolishing in all flesh the enmity, which is the law of commandments contained in ordinances, that in himself he might make the two into one new man, thus establishing peace, and might reconcile them both in one body to God through the cross, and by it having put to death the enmity. Then he quotes from Isaiah 57:19, and he became a and preached peace to you who were far away, and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access to access in one spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and of God's household, having been built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ himself being the cornerstone. Folks, let me tell you the breadth of God's love. He would take a Gentile outside of that time, the commonwealth of the covenant that he had cut with Israel, and he will graft you in through Jesus Christ's spilt blood. Because you are sitting here today, you have but tasted a small portion of the breadth of God's love for you. That's a big deal. You say, well, how big is it? Look at the day of judgment. Go to Revelation in chapter 7. We're going to see just a picture of the throne. Man, this is good stuff. It's hard not to get excited. Comes out of the remnant. In chapter 7, there's kind of an interlude, and there's a remnant in Israel. There's a multitude from the tribulation. And I want you to see in 7:9. And after these things, John witnessing this, the revelation. After these things, I, John, looked, and behold, a great multitude, which no one could count, from every nation and all tribes and peoples and tongues, standing before the throne and before the throne, clothed in white robes and palm branches were in their hands. And they cry out with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne and they worshiped God, saying, amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Let me tell you how big it is. Let me tell you the breadth of God's love. There will be a representative from every single tribe that was ever created, ever birthed on this earth. They will all, with us, be standing at the throne. And we will be gazing into the presence of the holiness of God, saying, worthy is the Lamb of God. And there will be no wall and no division. All saints will know the love of God. Can you imagine? No black, no white, no brown, no red, no yellow. All saints, purchased by the same blood, standing at the same throne, and on bent knee, in reverence and intensity of compassion, worthy is the Lamb of God. Oh, but there's three other dimensions to this ruler. He says, that's the breath. Well, Rob, then, what's next? Is that it? No, there's a length to it. Well, what is the length? I want you to take your scripture and just go back to chapter 1, beginning in verse 4. Actually, let's pick it up in verse 4. Well, let's go to verse 4. I second guess myself because I want to read the whole thing, but let's just read 4 and 5. So how long is it, Rob? I saw the breath. It's going to touch every tribe, every nation, every tongue. How about that love? How long is it? All right, here it is. Just as He, Christ, chose us in Him, Christ, before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before Him. In what? Love. Wow. He predestined foreknowledge us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to Himself, according to the kind intention of His will. So, Rob, how long is it? It is eternal. It did not have a begin point. It will not have an ending dot, period. When Christ sealed you through His sacrifice, regenerated you from above through the work at Calvary, sealed at the tomb, that was the point in time. But my dear friends, it went in eternity past my salvation. It will be found in eternity future. It never ends. It is going to touch every tribe, every tongue, every nature, and it is eternal. When somebody tells you, well, Rob, I don't know if I'm a believer today. I know I'm pretty sure I was yesterday. Folks, they don't know the depth of God's love like Scripture says. There is no losing. There is no recapturing. Folks, as much as I hate to say it, there is no rededication. That is not a biblical term. It's called repentance in Scripture. But you're not rededicating something as though you lost it, and it needs to be found in you again as a refinement. Christ is eternal in the life of the believer according to His Word. Never, ever to be outside of the commonwealth of His grace once He has in predestinated past eternally elected those whom He would call. Folks, that's the beauty of breadth and length. Oh, but He doesn't stop. He just gets another ruler out, and we're going to do some other measurements. So He says this, well, what is it that we need to be comprehending? Well, it's breadth and length, and He says height. What's the height of His love? Does it like cap out somewhere? We finally like get to the ceiling? We get to the pinnacle, maybe. And we stand on the rooftop at the very highest point. Really? I want you to look at chapter 1, verse 3, and then I want you to go over to chapter 2. I want to start with the blessedness, the kurios, the absolute satisfaction of knowing God. Chapter 1, verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Where? On earth? In the heavenly, what? Places in Christ. Go to chapter 2, verse 6. Well, okay, as a result of that, where am I at? How high does this thing go? Where am I at right now in Christ? Positionally, where am I? Oh, here it is. And raised us up with Him and seated us with Him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Folks, you know where I'm at positionally right now? Seated with Christ in His lap. Now, if that's not a dad moment, you tell me what is. You think about the times that you gathered your children up, men and women, who have experienced that. You tell me every single time you get the reader out or whatever, and it's bedtime, and those kids just pile up in your lap and you begin to read. You're no more at home than you are right there. Breath? Well, okay, what's the volume of that? Well, okay, He's going to reach all nations, tongues, and tribes. Well, goodness, how long is it? Well, it's eternal. What? How high is it, Rob? It's right in the seat, in the bosom of our Lord Jesus Christ. Is there anything bigger than that? Oh, but this is the one that we don't like. How about the depth? How deep is it? I want you to take your scripture and go to the second chapter of that same beautiful book that we're in, Ephesians, beginning in verse 1. I want you to mark 2 while you're there. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and we're going to immediately flip over there in verse 21, because we're going to read them as companion passages. Well, Rob, how deep is this love? This is how deep it is. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked, past tense, according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, of the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. Among them, we too all formerly lived in the lusts of our flesh, indulging the desires of our flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest, but God. Folks, when you see that contrast, man, you hang on to it. But God, being rich in mercy because of His what? Great love. What did He do? Which He loved us, even when we were dead and our transgressions, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. So how deep is it, Rob? He made Him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God in Him. Let me tell you, there's an aspect of the gospel that's not being preached anymore. It used to be preached when I was a kid growing up, and they called it hell and fire and brimstone. Folks, when I grew up, that was just the truth. We're depraved. We have no merit to stand before the Father. And I heard that as a kid. And listen, it didn't scare me. It was just a fact. I have warts. I can't deny it. I'm not okay outside of Christ. And I heard it every single time the gospel was preached. You mean to tell you the depth of God's love? He came out of heaven in a perfect place called holiness. And He was seated at the righteous seat beside the Father. And He came and condescended to the depths of hell that you and I might have salvation. That's how deep it is. He came and clothed Himself in humanity, never pouring Himself out of His deity, but robed Himself full in humanity. And He put on His sandals, and He put on an outer cloak, and His hair grew long, and He stunk and was filthy, and He hurt, and He got hungry, and He got thirsty, and He cried to His Father, but yet He did it because He loved you. But that's the humanity side of it. He suffered spiritually, as the Father would forsake Him at Calvary and turn His back on Him. That's how much He loves you. For the first and only time in all of eternity, God could not look upon His Son. Why? Because the depth of my sin was so great, He can't look on it. And guess who bore my sin and yours? It's a deep love. He got filthy for you and I. Folks, I don't know how many times I've watched my own earthly father in sacrifice walk out into the middle of a deep lot full of everything that a feedlot is full of to rescue one of us when we got our foot stuck in the muck and pulled our foot out of the boot and stood whining for daddy to come get us. And he didn't say, "Suck it up, son. Work it out. Come if you can." He came and rescued us and put our feet back on solid ground. Folks, that's how much God loves you. It will consume every nation, every tribe, every tongue. It is from eternity to eternity, everlasting in its existence. It is seated in the bosom of Jesus Christ as I speak. Positionally, I'm there. But it came to the depths of Sheol, hell, to save my soul. Big love or little love? You tell me. Big deal? You know what we need to start doing? Act like we're loved like that. So when I'm asked to do something that is uncomfortable, I do it anyway. Because that's what God wants. When asked to do something that I don't understand, I trust hard into Him. I lean heavy into Him. Because He is worthy of it. He can be trusted. When I don't understand my ways, would I just give them to Him? God, I know you're asking me to do this, but I don't know if I can do this. You can't, Rob. I never said you could. Trust me. I always can. And I've always said that I could. That's the God of the Bible. And He says, oh, I'll tell you this. I'll tell you how big it is. To know, gnosis. To experientially know. To have an experiential knowledge of this kind of love of Christ. It's going to surpass the knowledge that you can wrap your little head around. Is going to be out of this world experience. That you may be filled up to all the fullness of God. You know what it means to be filled up? Go home and try this. Kids, make sure mom's supervising if you do this. You get you a coffee cup and set it right up on the counter. Do this with water, please. It's easier to clean up if we surpass the rim. A surpassing knowledge to be filled up with the work of the Spirit means that I'm going to have an affection toward God, that I'm so fixed on Him, I will do in His will whatever He asks me to do. Let me tell you what it looks like metaphorically. That we fill that cup to where there is no surface left for another drop of water. Nothing is standing between me and God. Not in action. Not in my mind. Not in my past. Not in my fear of what's going to happen in my future. Not in my present ugliness. I'm filled to the brim. And there's no room left. It's a consumption of Jesus Christ, for He is worthy. Now you know why Paul broke into worship. Oh, but praise be to God. I want to know God that way. I want to quit living this cheap imitation of I come to church on Sunday morning and I check some cheesy box that I attended. And then I go home and I live like however I want to live. And I work at my workplace however I want to work. And I go to school. I do and say the things that the world looks like. And I don't look any different. I don't want to live that way. I don't want to live like that. And Paul says, church at Ephesus, I don't want you to live that way either. Oh, that you would just tap into the riches of His glory. Oh, and you would understand that there's dynamite in you in Christ. Oh, and by the way, He so desperately wants you to understand the depth of His love. To the place that it doesn't matter what happens. He's at home with you. Even in the recesses of those dark places, He can come. It's okay. I asked my dad one time, Dad, how do you know if it's the will of God? You know, and I guess just always growing up country, he does know the word, but just kind of growing up country, that's how he talks. He says, Rob, I'm just going to tell you simply. Here's the will of God. If you can, in sight, take Christ with you, and He's okay to go there, that's His will. But if you have to fold Him up and put Him in your pocket, you shouldn't be there either. Can I tell you, the church at Ephesus, come out of the nursery. Man, walk the streets of promised gold. Because you're a born-again child of God. Quit acting like the world. It's not about checking a box and doing some religious service. It's about living a life of fullness in Christ Jesus. Now I want to ask you, is that where you live? Is it? I want to tell you my answer, and you can do with this whatever you want. Sometimes I do, and sometimes I don't. But when I don't, I pray to God He would forgive me. My salvation is not in question. My sanctification is being choked out. I don't want to live like that anymore. So Paul prays this prayer to the church at Ephesus. Father, I thank you. We just look at the depth and the understanding of the volume in the word that which surpasses, goes beyond, Father, to be filled up with all fullness in God. Father, that's where we want to live. So I pray for this church that they would, with bent knee, approach you as their Father, that you would grant to them according to the riches of your glory to be strengthened with power through the work of your Spirit in us, the inner man, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith, and that you would be rooted and grounded in our hearts in love, and we may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and love and the depth of love which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled, each one of us in this congregation, with the fullness of God. Father, grant this according to your goodness. We'll be quick to give you the praise. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Rob. Another powerful sermon that hits too close to home, as it should. I think this is an appropriate song to end with. Let's stand and sing "It Is Well With My Soul."
grace and his goodness and faith and repentance. To make you alive in Christ is his greatest delight. His greatest honor is put on display when he rescues one lost soul. Yes. W.E.S. 99. He's going for one. Today, he's going to be looking at one. Don't harden your heart. Today's the day of salvation. If that's the case, you see him in the services. I'd love to show you that one. I want to read a passage of scripture. I want you to meditate on this for the remainder of the week before we close. Romans chapter 11, beginning in verse 33. To the marvelous work of God. And Paul begins his thus out in verse 33. Oh, the depth of the riches both of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and unfathomable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who became his counsel? Or who has given first given to him that it might be paid back to him? Now listen to this. For from him, and through him, and to him are all things. To him be glory forever and ever. Father, thank you for this time together. I just pray that there's so many lost that's in the congregation this morning that heard of the marvelous prayer of the Apostle Paul to you, Father, Abba, Dad. You would have touched their heart